good evening everybody who have joined us for this session. Sci Chronicle is a community forum which aims in creating an awareness about environment and scientific facts to the society. So we primarily conduct a lot of sessions. Since we are in between a pandemic, we conduct a lot of e-meets to take a lot of facts to the society and to bring out the myth that was earlier pertaining between the society. Since time immemorial, birds have never failed to inspire man's invention. They form an essential part of our ecosystem. Just like other organisms on this planet, birds find their own means to survive. Knowing their importance, still there is lack of awareness on conserving birds. Leaving all these thoughts behind, with no further delay, let us welcome the resource person for today, Mr. Karthikeyan. So he is currently doing his master's in ecology, but he has a very long relationship with birds, a part of which will be shared by him today. He has a very long performer, which explains his love and involvement in birding. He had been an intern at several renowned organizations across India, which includes Wildlife Conservation Society and Chennai Snake Park Trust. He completed his bird watching guide training organized by Department of Environment and Forest in association with the Directorate of Tourism, Andaman and Nicobar Administration, Port Blair. Welcome, Mr. Karthikeyan. Now the platform is yours. So before that, myself, Harini from Sci Chronicle. Yes, over to you, Karthikeyan.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for the lovely introduction, Harini. Okay. I hope everyone is doing fine and healthy in this hard time during the pandemic. Am I audible? Am I loud and clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank
you. People who have doubts, please drop your questions in the comment section. Okay. And we will address them in the end of the session. That'll be good. So without wasting any time, let's go into the session. I'll just begin the presentation now. Okay. Wait for a second here. Let me know when you see the screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, that's good. So the basic idea is today is to introduce you all to the field of bird watching. And I'll tell you how using few characteristics, you can narrow it down to a particular bird that you're seeing. Okay. So here are the things that you will learn today. So starting with, we will be discussing about a bird identification, wherein I will tell you how using some key elements that you can observe in the field will help you in the post-processing and identifying a particular bird. So I'll tell you some key features using which we can narrow it down to a particular bird. Okay. Then we will discuss about field guides. Okay, what is field guides and how it can be efficiently used, etc., will be discussed wide and clear later in this part. We have a separate slide for it. Then I'll be discussing about field equipments. So starting off with binoculars. See, binoculars can bring the object in the field optically closer to your eye. So binoculars are really, really important. Okay, so then we have spotting scope. I'll show you what a spotting scope is right away. Stay with me. So this is how a spotting scope looks like. Okay, and everybody knows how a camera looks. So I don't think we have to worry about it. Okay, so we have spotting scope, which will help in looking a far-sighted bird. Okay, then we have cameras using which we can take photograph, of course. Then we will introduce you to eBird. See, I really don't want to introduce you to eBird, actually, since you're a beginner. eBird is not really necessary for a beginner right now, I personally feel. Since I have mentioned it in the flyer, I'll go about it. Then we'll discuss about do's and don'ts in the field. There are various things that you shouldn't do in the field and various things that you should be following in the field. Then we will discuss about the general birding tips. Okay, that you can make use in the field when you're around. So first things first, what is bird watching and what do we do? So would anyone want to answer to that question? Anybody want to talk about it. Just a small introduction on that. Anyone? No? Okay. So bird watching or birding as a form of wildlife observation in which the bird travels to many habitats like forest patches, it travels to shores, it travels to grasslands, it travels to hilltops, it travels to mangroves. So it goes around to various locality in a region and observes birds. Okay, so they record the number of species observed in that region, which species found in that region, their behavior, they record their calls if possible. All these contribute in learning about the birds. Okay, so these are the things that a birder follows when he goes into the field. And you know, birding is probably one of the most sought outdoor activity that is in existence in the world right now. And birders come from all walks of life, actually. They range from intense perfectionists who travel around the world to observe a life species. Now that I have used the term life species or a lifer. And what is a lifer? Again, would anyone want to answer to that question? Okay, as you know. So a lifer is the first ever sighted species by a person, which in our case is birds. If you see a bird for the first time in your life, that is your first time that you're watching the bird in your entire life. So that species becomes your lifer. So many people have different list of lifers. I have, I think, more than 600, 800 lifers yet to look at and go around to see it. I have nearly seen 300, 400 species alone right now. So I have a lot of lifers to observe. So lifer is that term. And moving on, and there are many birders who are just casual hobbyists. See, they are not professionalists. They like going in the field. Like a few people like going in the field, spend their time in the nature. They like the colors of the bird. It is aesthetic to the eye. They like to listen to the songs in the morning that can be melodious to the air. Okay. Bird watching could be a very beautiful recreation or a hobby for someone. Okay. And there are a lot of health benefits to bird watching. Okay. Especially like you walk for a particular kilometer. So that improves your cardiovascular activity and it can help you burst your stress from a busy week when you're in the field, when you're in the nature. Okay. It can enhance your mental alertness. It can enhance your reflexes, because when you see a bird and you tend to react so fast, you take out your binocular, you observe them keenly, you track them down. So these all enhance your reflexes. And also bird watching can give you a change of scenario. Okay, you go to a different landscape and you have a different view. So this gives you a change of scenery. Okay, so then I'll tell you things that you need for bird watching. This is a really important thing that a beginner should know. So now that we have discussed what a bird watcher is, the bird watcher do, and what they do in the field, and what do we need to begin bird watching in itself. So first thing is the common question here, know the right time for bird watching. Okay, this is a very common question. When to start bird watching? Should I start in the early in the morning? Should I start in the evening? I would say you will observe birds, although all both of the time, but the comparatively birds will be seen more in the earlier hours in the morning, because birds come out of their nest after roosting. Their activity is really high in the morning. They go for go around looking for feed, and they go around looking for materials for their nest. So early morning could be a best time for bird watching, and that is one suggestion. Then you need to have a binocular. See, having a binocular is, again, I would say, is a personal choice. There are people who can afford binocular and there are people who cannot afford a binocular. And people who cannot afford binocular, for them, see, it's not necessary that you need to have a binocular. People without binocular can also go bird watching. They can use the naked eye to observe birds, but the observation will be very scantiful. It will not be accurate. So if you want to observe them and you want to take notes on them, having a binocular will really help you, since it will bring the object close to your eye optically, and you can note down the things that I'll be telling you after these slides. So it is necessary that you buy a binocular. So there are various binoculars in the market. You can go for Carl Zeiss, you can go for Nikon brands, and you can go for other brands such as Olympus. I'm using Olympus 8x42, which cost me 4,000 4 years back. Okay, so you can look on look about it in the internet, check in Amazon or in Flipkart, whichever suits your budget, you can buy with that. Okay, next thing is field guide. So you need to have a field guide. Field guide is a descriptive text about birds, which we will discuss later. Okay, next thing we need to have is a notepad. Excuse me. Notepads are really necessary for making observation. You cannot always rely upon your mind. See, everything that you see in the field will not be registered in your mind entirely. So you need to take down notes while in the field, note down every characteristics, every behavior. You need to note down all the other activities in the notepad, which will help you, you know, after you go home and look at the notes, you can be able to identify a bird using all those characteristics. I'll explain about it, how these characteristics will help you in learning about the birds. So, okay, let's do one thing. We have now understood that we need these things and we know what bird watches do now. So next thing is identifying a bird. Imagine now, like one of the participant is in the field. Okay, he has gone into a rainforest now, or in shore, beach, or he is in the grassland, anywhere. And he has observed a bird. And now that he has come back to his home, and telling this to a person or telling this to a birder who has knowledge on birds. So he is explaining like this. Will it serve any purpose? See, a lot of the time, this is how people explain it to me. When I ask them to describe the bird that they have seen yesterday, this is how they describe. It was black and yellow. It was not much big in size. It was eating something. I don't know. So first thing is, we have to learn how to describe a bird. So let's learn how to describe a bird. So what we need to do is, first thing is to, you know, compare the bird that we saw with the birds that we already know that are common in nature. So would anyone want to identify the first bird? Please guys, answer. Like, this will be very silly if you don't know. Guys, are you there?
Yes.
What is the first bird?
Crow.
Yes. Exactly. Yes. Exactly. It's a house crow. The second bird is common. The third one.
Sparrow.
Which is sparrow, ma'am?
The second bird.
I'm sorry to disappoint you. The second bird is a common minor. I'm really happy that you made that mistake, actually. Now I'll tell you how to not make that mistake.
First one is sparrow, third one is minor.
Okay, you're going from down. Yeah, that's correct. Okay, so I'm coming from the top. So the first one here is the house crow, second one being the common minor, third one is red-whiskered bulbul, and fourth one being the house sparrow. Exactly right, ma'am. You got it that right. So, like you see, this is a small bird and a bigger one to the largest one. So this is how you have to, you know, describe a bird when you don't know the size. You have to place the bird that you have observed between the known birds. See, for example, I'll show you one example right here. So this bird, sunbird, this is a very small bird, which is like 10 centimeters to 12 centimeters in long. So where will you put that bird with among these groups? Will you put that between crow and minor? Will you put that between Maina and Bulbul, will you put that between Bulbul and Sparrow? Anyone?
Bulbul and Sparrow.
That's a very good answer. Exactly. So that's how it is. So you have to compare the known, compare the bird that you saw with a known bird. Okay, this is how you put it. So let's take another example for that, for the understanding. So we have your Indian roller, which is 27 centimeters in height, okay, in length. So where will you put the bird among these features?
Between Aina so, and the bulbul.
So how can I identify the height?
Yes, sir.
How can I identify of height of bird?
Flight of a bird. Can you type that question? Can I answer to that in the last, in the after the session? If you don't have a problem with that. Okay, sir. So this is how you do it. So roller, somebody answered, you will put that between Maina and
Trijan.
Yeah. So sorry that I'm not looking at the names right now. I'm looking at the slides. I'm sorry if I'm not calling out names. Okay. So you will place the bird between Maina and Bulbul, which is a very close guess. I would not say that you are wrong, but that bird would rightly fit between
Crow
and Maina.
And the Maina.
Exactly, sir. So this is where it will put. It will come. So this is how you describe the size and shape first. Okay. Okay, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes.
So next important thing that you have to learn is the body parts of a bird. Okay. And I'll tell you why is it necessary. So let's start with the different parts that are shown here. This region is called crown. This region is called the nape. And this region is scapula, this region is rump, this region is vent, and this region is all, as it says, all mentioned here. Okay, so see, why is it necessary to understand the bird parts? See, some birds are technically identified by their parts. Okay, they are named by their parts. The name itself starts from the crown. The name is identified by its name. The bird species is identified by its rump and rump color. Okay, so that is why you have to be sure about the bird parts. So when you go after the observation, you can describe that near the nape region, I saw red color. Near the rump region, I saw yellow color. So that will be very specific. You cannot tell that in the back or near head. That will be not specific, but there will be the explanation will be really, really, you know, scantiful. You will not be clear to explain to the person you want to explain. So let's take a few examples. I'll tell you a few examples which are represented by their parts. So begin with the crown. Okay, so there are black crown night heron, which is represented by its crown. We have rufous crowned sparrow. We have crowned eagle. So these three birds are identified by their peculiar part, that is crown. Okay, we have next nape. So we have white-trumped munia. We have white-trumped sandpiper. Nape. I have just given you a wrong example. So for the nape, we have blue-naped pitta, we have black-naped monarch, we have black-naped tern. Okay. For the rump, we have white-trumped munia, white-trumped sandpiper. Okay. Similarly, for vent, we have red-vented bulbul, a red-vented barbet, chestnut-vented warbler, etc. See. As I'm saying, red vented. So the vent is which color? It is red in color. So that is a peculiar characteristics of the particular bird. So red vented bird will have a red color vent. So that is how it is identified. So understood the importance of bird parts now. So let's move on to the next slide. Different types of beaks. Again, for a beginner, this is really not necessary. Because, you know, a lot of expert birders also, I mean, they fail in explaining the different beak types also. But since I have mentioned it, let's learn. Let's see some of the examples for these types of birds, beaks. Okay. Beak is this region, front part. Okay. It's also called as bill. All right. So we have a generalist type of beak. We have insect catching beak. Then we have green, grain eating beak. Then we have nectar feeding. We have chiseling type. We have scything. We have filter feeding type. We have scavenging and adaptive. See, why are beaks so modified in all these birds? So beaks are used for feeding, and they are modified according to each species need. So some birds feed on insects, so they need that type of beak, and some birds that feed on grain eating. So for example, we have munia, okay, that feed on grain. So that can be one example. For nectar feeding, we have sunbirds, and we have hummingbird, which needs to have a long proboscis, long beak, which will help them collect nectar easily. And then we have chiseling type of beak, which is for woodpeckers modification type. So they use these type of beaks for chiseling the bark, and they build their nest. Then we have these type of beak dip netting, which is seen in pelicans. Okay. Then we have filter feeding, which is seen in flamingos. Okay. Then we have scavenging type of beaks, which is seen in raptors such as vultures. And then we have raptorial. We can see in Bessera and eagles, etc. And these can be seen in pied and other birds. These can be seen in skimmers. Okay. A lot of examples that I can give you right now. But this is how you have to understand that different types of beaks are there in different birds. And this is very, very specific. See, these type of beak is not helpful in the forest. This is needed when they are near the water body. And these type of cannot help in the shore region, because it is more common. These type of birds will be seen where there are nectar some more, where there are fruiting trees, where there are lot of flowers. Okay, so this is the kind of different beaks that are seen among birds. Okay, so now that we have seen those two striking characteristics, first thing being the size, we now know the size. Then what will you check next in the bird? Okay, then you will go for plumage. What is the plumage now, and what do you mean by its pattern? So plumage is nothing but it is the layer of feathers that cover a bird, and the pattern, color, and arrangement of these feathers onto the body of the bird. Okay, plumage, if you see, it varies in different stage of lifespan. It is different when it comes to juvenile bird of the same species I'm talking. Okay, it is different when it is in the juvenile, and it is different when it is being adult. And it molds into a different color of plumage during breeding season, and it is different in non-breeding season, and it is also different between males and females. Okay, and it is also being said that the plumage varies between species and subspecies within. Okay, so I don't think we need to have a conversation on subspecies and bird species now. That is a different topic right now, so we don't have to go much detail in the beginning session. Okay, I'll show you an example if you do not understand what do I mean by different plumage among various stage. I'll just show you. So here we have a rosy starling. If you see, can you see my screen, guys? Guys?
Yes.
Okay. So if you see it onto the right, the juvenile looks different compared to the adult one. Okay. Can you see the difference? I'll open up. Can you see there is no rosy color? It's very dull in color. It's not so bright. And the beaks are also very dull in color. And you can see the size difference also. Okay. Similarly, if you see the breeding adult, this is how the breeding adult looks. Don't you guys feel this is very different from what you saw in the juvenile? This color rose was not apparent in the somebody wants to say something. Okay, so the color is very apparent when compared to a juvenile. So, and this is a non-breeding one. If you see, it develops into another molting, which is different from the different from these colors. Okay, so Did you guys understand the difference now? How the plumage varies between juvenile, adult, and non-breeding, and male and female. Okay, that's good. Thank you. So next thing we have here is the dominating color. So now that you understood what plumage is, so what, sir, now what should I do with the plumage? Now that I'm seeing it, looking at a bird and it has a color, so what should I look and what should I note down? You have to note down a dominating color from that bird. Okay, you have to dominate which color was more prominently looking in that bird. Like previously we saw rosy starling, so rose, black were the dominating color and yellow beak was another indicator. So let's do a pattern. Okay, who is going to tell me which is the three striking color in the common manana? Guys?
In the second bird.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, this bird. Can you see the pointer? Okay.
Yeah, I can see. In that bird, brown is...
okay, one color.
Color.
Brown is one color.
And,
what else you, which color do you see?
And the darkest brown.
Yeah, brown is one color and then we have black and then we have which color?
Yellow.
Yellow. So these are three main colors that you are looking in the common manana. Similarly, when you look at a parakeet, you will say green, then you will say blue, and then you will mention the red color. Okay, and when it comes to other birds such as for say dove, okay, you will say the brown color, blue color, etc. So whichever bird you're seeing, you have to note down which striking colors you are looking at. You have to mention which color you are seeing. Okay, you have to mention whether it whether the body had black color, whether it had blue or green, whatsoever dominating color you're looking at, you have to mention all of them together. Okay, then we have distinct feature. So now that we have seen the size and we now saw the plumage, how to mention about the plumage, then we have a distinct feature. See, each bird exhibits a distinct feature. They have some character, key characteristics that is different from other birds. So for example, we have crown, like some birds have crown. For example, a Eurasian hoopoe has a crown and we have black crown night heron, which has a crown. So not every bird has a crown. Okay. So this can be one indicative feature which will help us narrowing it down to a particular bird species that we have observed. So whole point is what? We have to narrow it down to a particular species that we are observing. So this is how you will do. You have to identify or look for a distinct character that is seen in the bird. So first example being a crown. Next is fork tail. These are some of the examples. There are a lot of examples that I can to give, but this is some to explain how you should be looking at a bird. Fork tail, if you see, it can be seen in drongos. Drongos have a forked tail. It is in heart shape. Somebody's unmuted his mic. Sorry. So fork tails can be seen in drongos. So, and also be seen in the swift. So these characters can help you narrow it down to other side in another way. Then we have beak shapes. As I showed you in the picture, we have different beak shapes. You have to look whether it was long, whether it was pointy, whether it was blunt. So all these things can help you identifying the bird. Next thing is wagging tail. So not all bird wags its tail. So for wagging tail, we have an example. So examples such as forest wagtail, we have white-throated wagtail. Okay, these birds wag their tail. Also robins, oriental magpie robins, they also wag their tails. They open up their tails. Okay, they keep it raised. And some birds also exhibit mimicry. For example, drongos exhibit mimicry, rufous treepie exhibits mimicry, some mynas of course do mimicry. Mimicry is what? Imitating other birds or sounds nearby. So drongos exhibit very prominently. They, sometimes I have heard that they exhibit Indian pitta sound. which is really, really rare. I mean, they copied out everything that they hear from the surrounding. So these distinct feature can help you, you know, identifying a bird also. Okay. Moving on, we have behavior, we have activity. So what behavior did the bird exhibit when you were observing? And also, were the bird solitary? Was it paired? Was it in flock? See, not every bird flies in flock. Flock is the term used for group of birds. So like we have bunch of bananas. Similarly, we have flock for group, that is indicated for the group of birds. So not many birds fly in flocks, okay? And not every bird roam in pair. So we have example for flock as such as her ducks fly in flocks, and we have sparrows that fly in flocks, okay? And for pair, we have doves that go in pair, okay, bulbuls that go in pair. Can one of you tell me which bird is solitary? I mean, can you name one bird that can, that you see a solitary? Solitary is being single. It does not go in flock. It does not go in pair. It likes to stay alone. It likes to hunt it.
Eagle?
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. So eagles are solitary in nature. So like I said, right? So I have given example of ducks. I have given example of pair. When I'm telling that I saw two birds that were in pair, so I clearly option out some of the birds that are not possible because those birds are not seen in pair. So these are some of the observation that you can take, observe from nature. Okay, this will help you enhance your bird watching skills. So some people miss out these things, but this is also an important observation that you should be making. Next thing is feeding. So how a bird feeding can help you understand its help you understand which species it is. It can really help you. Let me give you an example. Like if the bird was feeding, then what was it feeding on? Was it feeding on an insect? Was it feeding on a fruit? A fruit-eating bird, as a frugivorous bird, we have a different list of birds. We have insectivorous birds that are different list of birds. Okay, this will help us tell you which bird species did you watch. So, for example, for insect-eating birds, we have blue-tailed honeyeater bee-eaters. Okay, we have other prenias. So these birds all feed on insects, and some feed on the fruits. You have seen the bird in the fig tree that was eating fruit. So that will narrow it down to some extent again. Then comes to perch. How can, I mean, and perching, bird perched on a tree will help us knowing a species. How is that possible? It is possible. See, when it comes to warblers, which is like if there are any good bird watchers in this group also, they will agree with me that warblers are very tough to identify. And how to identify these warblers when it comes to perching? Perching can also tell you to identify to a particular species. For example, there are warblers, okay, they do not perch in the high region. So some warblers, they take lower perch, such as the ground region, and some take the intermediary, some take the top region. Okay, so the birds that are achieving the intermediary does not come to the lower ground, and that is holding the lower position ground feeding will not come to the higher perch. Okay, so this will help you distinguish between two warbler species when it I'm giving this example particularly for warblers, and other birds can also be indicative of this type of exhibition, such as some birds are sitting in the high perch or high tree, high canopies. Some birds are taking bushes. Some birds are sitting in the 20 meter high tree. So these all will help you identifying a bird again. Okay. Then it comes to preening. A preening is nothing but a self-grooming technique in which the bird arranges its feather structure, straightens its feather, and it it dries off its feathers and it opens up its wings. Yes, sir.
I mean, is it peacock? Does peacock do preening?
Yeah, they do. They use their beaks to you know, preen their body. So preening is that way is helpful. Some birds, we have cormorants, for example. In the end of the session, I'll show you some of the pictures that I have taken, okay, in the field. I'll show you one of the picture wherein a cormorant, Indian cormorant, is preening, okay? So preening is nothing but, yeah, so again, using its beak to arrange its feather pattern, okay? They want to arrange it in a feather pattern, they line it up, they dry it up, okay, using their body oil. So this is one observation that you can make, okay? So if you have seen Indian cormorants doing this, I'll be able to tell you that this can be an Indian cormorant because I have seen Indian cormorant doing the same, and a lot of other birds doing the same, exhibition. See, it is very common. You might have seen it, like birds opening up its feathers and doing straightening its feathers using its beak. I think you might have seen it. If not, you will observe it next time, and you will definitely know that that is preening. Okay. Next thing is singing. Was the bird singing? The bird's word note, was this long? Was it short? Was it in continuous call? Was it a single note call? So all these is again observation. Then was the bird roosting? And did it exhibit any kind of territorial behavior? Territorial behavior, like, have you guys seen crow chasing down eagle, crow chasing down kites, or crows chasing down big birds?
Yes, we have watched it.
So it is a territorial behavior, okay? The bird does not like other strange bird coming into their territory and endanger their food or their resource. So that's when the bird exhibits territorial kind of behavior. Territorial behavior can be aggressive, also chasing down or attacking, okay? So these observations under behavior and activity can also help you narrowing down to bird species, okay? All these points are really, really important. Don't miss out any of these points. Note down every possible observation that you are making related to the bird. Okay.
What about the flying pattern?
Yes, ma'am.
Flying pattern.
Flying pattern, yes, it's also an observation, ma'am. I'm giving some of the explanations. Flying patterns can also be helpful. Are they soaring? Are they gliding? How their wings are, you know, after the opening of the wingspan, how can you see the primaries and secondaries? What color are they? You can observe all these things, but that is, possibly one of the points that I forgot to mention, and thanks for you, okay, for reminding me. Ma'am, your name?
I'm Uma J. Vinod. I've done my PhD in Nilgiri Pipit.
Okay.
So with the flying pattern only, we could identify that sort of bulbuls and all, and that sort of birds,
yes,
we can identify with the flying pattern on.
Yes, so definitely with flying pattern, you can narrow it down. Like what happens in some accipiter species also, when they're in the flight, it's really hard to identify them. So we have to take a picture of the bird flying when they are in the flying mode. And we have to take picture of that. We can see the underpart.
Nowadays we have many gadgets like video camera and all. We can record that, and afterwards we can identify the birds.
Absolutely, ma'am. Next thing is habitat. Now the question is, what can habitat tell about a bird? Like, does all habitat have same kinds of birds? Definitely no. Like each habitat, you know, holds a different kind sets of organism. It holds different kinds of bird species. Okay, for example, if you go into a thick wooded jungle, a tropical jungle or a thick wooded jungle, you will see hornbills, drongo, woodpeckers, rails, etc. When you move down to grassland, you will see bioweaver, you will see preenias, you will see monia. And when you go to the beaches or shores, you can see beach thickneys, you can see terns, gulls, egret, reef egrets, you can see many shorebirds, pelagic birds. Okay, then lakes and wetlands, if you go to that place, you will see ducks, flamingos, pelicans, grebes, plovers, sandpipers, etc. And in the open route urban habitat, you can see shrikes, you can see bulbuls, mynas, doves, etc. Okay, excuse me. So, an habitat will definitely define a particular bird. So as I told you, each habitat has a different set of organism that it holds. So when you note down, you also note about note down the habitat that you're going into, whether you observed these birds in the wetland, whether did you notice it near the shore, did you watch it in the, did you look at, spot it in the jungle? You have to be specific about it. This helps you again further, you know, narrowing it down to a particular species. Then comes word calls. Do we need to pay attention to the call across the bush? Do we have to? Anybody answering?
Sure, sir. You have to give attention.
Yes.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah, ma'am is right. Yes, we need to pay attention to the calls across the bush. Many a times what happens, we think that bird watching is only about looking at birds and spotting them and observing them. But bird calls can play an important role in identifying the birds, okay? And it is not possible that you look the bird every time. The birds are sometimes in the deep bush. The birds are sometimes inside the bush. That it does not come out. Birds are sometimes, birds can sometimes shy. Somebody's mic is on. Can you? Okay, thank you. So bird call is really, really important. And why do birds make call? And are all calls same? Like birds make call for varied reasons. There are multiple reasons to why birds make their calls. And all calls are not same. Okay, so there are different types of calls, such as hatchling begging calls. So when the parent bird goes on for foraging or looking for food, the hatchlings that are in the nest, they screech and they look out for food and they expect their parents to come. So they screech onto that. That is hatchling call. And we have threat calls wherein a strange bird or a foreign bird comes into that specific region and it feels threat. So it, you know, kind of evokes a particular type of tone of call that is to that is to alert other birds and other species that somebody has come into our territory. So it is to chase away. And we have mating calls wherein it is used to mate with other fellow species, okay, to communicate and also to mate. So we have seen all these kinds of things in the Discovery channels. We have seen this in many movies, many documentaries. So calls are specific and calls are really important to observe. So one thing that I would suggest you to is, since we have all a mobile phone with us and everybody is having a mobile phone, we can record those calls if possible and play it later when you go to home, and you can cross check it with the birds that you have narrowed it down. And I mean, you have above points that you have for a particular species. When you have come to a conclusion, you can play the calls of that particular bird and cross compare it with this particular call that you have. If not, this bird call can be of different species. You can learn about it by playing other calls. You can get access to bird calls from eBird, and there are other sources where you can download bird calls. Okay. So it is important that you listen to the bird calls and make a record of it if possible. Next is field observation and note making. And again, so now that you have seen all these criteria and you have seen all the important features that are told, so how important is this to have an observation, and why is it important that you make a note? So as I told you before also, you cannot keep everything to your mind. You cannot remember all those important points in your mind, okay? You have to write it down, only then you won't miss out. So before you start making your observation, I would recommend you to take a good observation on the bird. So take a careful observation on the bird before you take off your eye. So what happens sometimes, you are busy taking notes and the bird flies off and you cannot write down all the points. So before you go to your book, I would recommend you to take a clean, good sight of the bird. Okay, use your binocular if you have. Okay, so go for it. and write down all the points and make a rough sketch, if possible, of the pattern or color distribution. Okay, you can mention like this. You can write out the major colors. You can describe the size. Okay, we know now how to describe the size of the bird. Okay, you can write down. You can describe the shape. Was it buffier? The chest region? Was it slender? Okay, so I have given this synonym here, hedge belt. So hedge here stands for the head region, B ear for beak or body, or E ear for eyes, and L for leg region, and T for tail. You can write which color did these parts have. Okay, you can try to draw a rough sketch. You don't have to, you know, go on for detailed sketching here. Okay, you just have to draw a rough sketch here, and which will help you in identification of the bird. And try to be quick enough. And okay, what happens, as I told you before, what happens, you miss out the bird. And while you make a one species sketch, and there comes in another bird who sits in the same perch, okay, then it's a difficult position for you to observe two birds at a time. So you have to first observe the characteristics of each bird and then go on detailed writing. Okay, then we have field guide. Okay, so we need to understand what is a field guide and why do we need it? Is it necessary? Which field guide shall I use? There are plenty in market. So I address each one of it. Okay, so field guide is a book that has a collection of images, which has a descriptive text, which has a range map, it has distribution of the particular species, it has its voice being written, whether it is a single note bird, a single note voice, or was it a triple note call, etc. And it has details on its habitat, it has detail of its size, it has details of the bird's conservation status, IUCN status of the bird. So these helps a bird watcher identify a bird. Okay, I'll give you a demonstration. I mean, I'll give you an example. I'll show you how the field guide looks. Okay, and also going on to the second question, there are several excellent publications on the market. Okay, so that are both portable and complete. A person can go with any one of these which they feel okay with. Okay, so there are these many collection of field guides that are available in the market. One need to choose according to the need and the budget they have. So again, budget plays an important role. Okay, there are people who can afford good books that are costly. Let me tell you one thing, guaranteed, that all these books are one and the same. They give the same description, they have the same details, just the cover books are different, and there are some minor differences. Okay, like they have, like if you see the birds of the Indian subcontinent, this book particularly has a good distribution table, and Birds of India has very good photo description of the birds. It has a colorful real photographs. Birds of Indian subcontinent is a very famous book, and also it has descriptions, but they are not pictographical. We have Book of Indian Birds by Salim Ali sir already. Okay, so there are these many books. You can go with any one of these that you like. Okay, you can browse through the internet for this particular species. So let's show you again a picture where how to use these field guide. Now, like we have the next question here, how to use the field guide to ID a bird. Since it is an online session, I'm sorry that I'm unable to show you in real. I can give a small example as to how you can use book to identify a bird. Now that you have seen a bird, you are having a rough idea of the bird right now. Okay, first thing that you have to do is go to the family summary that is in the front page of the book or the field guide, where you will have a different family summaries. So it is, for example, you see ducks are in a single family, and the shearwaters are in different family, grebes are in different family, we have flamingos separately. So looking by the images, so see, if you see an egret, you can come to bitterns and herons. It comes under Ardidae family. So this is how you first start identification looking at the family glossary. The next thing you do is, this is another example. You see doves are separately placed in the Colymbidae family. Okay, so first you have to go look at the family summary first. Then second thing you have to do is go to the last section of the book where it has indexes on the different name. First, that you have seen that if, for example, you have identified some bird as a babbler. Okay, so here you, if you see, there are a lot of babbler species from this to this. There are n number of babbler species starting from page 470 to 493. Okay, you will have a photo description of each species there. You can compare your bird with the bird that is given in the book. So let's have an example. Let's suppose we have identified a yellow bird, okay, and we think that it might be an oriole. So, and the bird that we observed is an Indian golden oriole. So what information does the book give us regarding Indian oriole? If you see in the beginning, first you will see a distribution chart. Okay, first part is the red in color, second part is in blue. The blue represents the winter migration. During winter migration, they travel to the south, and in the summers, they are seen in this region. Okay, but it is not accurate, but this is how they are observed. Okay, next thing we can see here is the size. So this bird is of 25 centimeter high. Its voice call is a flutty whistle. This is how they make sound. Okay, they have this range. They are summer visitor to the Himalayan foothills, spreads in the winter to the plains, and breeds in many parts of the peninsula, as I said. Then their habitat. So now, remember I told you the importance of habitat. Look at this now. So they are describing it can be seen in the forest, orchards, gardens, and other habitations. Okay. Then they have a detailed description of the bird, of its feather, or whether which part is what color, etc. are all given in this description. And we have a picture of them in flight here on the right. And we have a breeding plumage on the center. And we have a juvenile. Okay. So this will help us in comparison of the bird. Okay. Any question regarding this? I'll take them in the end. Okay. So next being any bird. Now that you have identified a bird and you know you have a field guide and you have all the characteristics now, you have all the data. Okay, what shall I do with the data? What's like, can it be used for any purpose? Are there people who can benefit out of these data? Datas are always helpful. Datas are really imperative for scientific research. Okay, so datas are really necessary. So how can we use those data? Can we put that data into some database? So we have so many questions regarding this. So as I told you in the earlier slide, that eBird is not necessary for the beginners. I'll explain why. What happens is most of the times the beginners are not able to identify the bird properly. They misidentify it and they mention wrong words in the eBird. So and that goes into error page. So that's how the sightings differs and the data are a little bit manipulated. So I would say eBird is not really necessary for a beginner. Maybe you can use it for various other reasons, which I will be explaining right now. So what is an eBird? See, eBird is an online platform. Okay, developed by Cornell Lab of Ornithology, USA. It is an international organization wherein they store details of the birds, their migration, their distribution, and they also contribute to conservation. Okay, so what information do I get here? You will get informations like birds photographs here. Okay, you will see the distribution graph here of a particular species. If you want to search about rosy starling, you can explore rosy starling in this eBird. You can type it rosy starling, and you will see the distribution of rosy starling in the entire world where it is seen, and what are the number of observation people have made, which region has seen the latest. Okay, all this information will be there. You will have bird calls, you will have videos. Okay, these informations are helpful for scientific community. These information help researchers understanding the climate change, the birds' migration pattern, and what happens sometimes some birds migrate too early or they start their migration too late. So people try to understand these concepts using the observation made throughout the world. Recently, what happened in Andamans, people saw Asian open-billed being dead in several regions. So these birds were affected by the cyclone that recently happened. Okay, so they were making a passage trip and they got hit by these cyclones and they died there. So observation that was recorded from Andaman has contributed in understanding that cyclones have an effect in the travel passage of birds. So this is how these information can be understood, and many researchers use these data to also understand, use this data into their scientific research. As somebody has told that they have done a PhD in pipit, so they can also download few data from pipit. Suppose a researcher who is doing research on pipit and they cannot travel in entire India and they want to collect data, then they can rely on this secondary data that is available on the internet. So people will really be helpful understanding the data that are provided by the citizens. Okay, and there are various organizations that collect citizen science data. Okay, eBird is one of the platform. There are various other platform which collects data. eBird is widely being used. So I am quoting eBird, and people who are in the bird watching community, they kind of prefer eBird. Because it is easy to access and it is easy to gather all the information, and it is most famous also. So people are using it, and as I'm telling, there are many other organizations that they collect eBird data, bird data or animal data. So now let's go into the part where how to use eBird. So I'll give you a live demonstration, okay, as to how to use these eBird for your understanding. So I have already logged into my account. You can see my name here. So this is how the interface looks like. Okay, we have an option on the top that says submit, wherein we can submit our data. We have an option where we can explore about a particular species, as you can see in this tabular column, and you can explore a region as in this region. I can really explain a few things right here. Like if you want to explore species, anybody who wants to explore something, can you name a bird species that you know? Guys, are you all sleepy?
Arctic tern.
Somebody said Arctic tern and somebody said kingfisher. We'll do Arctic tern first, okay? Let's type in tern. Okay, eBird shows a different ranges of terns which are there. So if we do Arctic tern, can you see the Arctic tern? Okay, I'll type in them.
I saw there.
Yeah, I found it. So I'm opening up Arctic tern. So in the first page, we are looking at the Arctic tern bird here. This is how an Arctic tern looks like. And its breeding plumage is like this. Its non-breeding plumage is like this. Okay. Can you see the difference in breeding plumage? Its beak color is modified. And in the non-breeding adult, it is different. Can you guys see the difference?
Yes, sir.
And also, remember I told you about the tail pattern. Can you see the difference? We cut here the four tails. So this is how if you're in the field and you're looking at tern, and this tail region can be one of the key features that can help you narrowing down of species. Okay. And also you observe the colors. The beak was orangish red in color. The nape region is black. Okay. You have to mention all these things. Okay, so we have Arctic tern here. So what information do I get regarding Arctic tern? So we have identification of Arctic tern. These are all the identification characteristics that are available. And then moving down, we have 86,460 e-bird observations so far. Okay. And it on the right, you can see the distribution of the Arctic tern from North America till, I think, till Middle East. You can taste till Europe also. Till Europe, you can see its distribution on the, and if you see, it is all in the Northern Hemisphere. Okay, these are some of the observations that you can make. So next thing we can do is explore a region. Let's explore our own country. Okay, India here. Okay, I'm opening up India. So how many species of birds are observed here? Can you see? There are 1,338 bird species observed, and there are 1.2 million checklists. Checklist is the list of birds that you upload. In one checklist, you upload all kinds of birds that you saw in that particular day. So it has all the list of birds that are seen in India. Okay, if you want to be more specific, you can change the place. Okay, you can change the location if you want to change. In India, you can also go for, okay, on the right, you can see the recent visits, who made the recent update, and who are the top e-birders in India. E-birders are who have uploaded a lot of bird checklist here, and also based on the number of species observed. Shashank Dalvi here is a renowned wildlife biologist who has observed 1,229 bird species. Okay, so we have top state provinces which has provided a lot of bird species list. In number one, it has West Bengal. If you open up West Bengal, you can see the entire birds that are seen in West Bengal. You can again narrow it down to particular place. If you want to go to Siliguri, if you want to go to other places, you can narrow it down. You can option out everything that you want. And we have a term here. What is top hotspots? See, hotspots are region where biodiversity is really high, wherein you can see a lot of different species living in that region. Okay, so the higher number of hotspots is observed in Coppet National Park. I think that's for e-bird exploration and region. Like if now you're a beginner, if you want to submit a data that you want to upload, so this is how it opens up. You have three stages of it. You have to first find it where, which place you want to. So let me first put, okay, Kanchipuram. Let me put India. So I am going to upload a checklist that I have observed in India. Then I have to be region specific where in India. If I put Chennai, okay, I'm typing in Chennai and I'm going to Chennai. Okay, and in Chennai region, which region you want to be specific? If you want to be specific, you can be specific where in Chennai. You can then continue. Okay, I suppose I am selecting this region. So see, these are the observations, and these are the places where birds are mostly seen. These are all hotspots. Okay. These are not accurate. People just, you know, themselves make hotspots by themselves. So that is why I don't want people to go into e-bird. They put wrong information. Not every place has more number of bird observation. There are chances that we have overlapping. The people who are observing in this region and people who are observing in this region, what do you think is the different kind of species that they will observe? There is no, there are not a big distance from these two hotspots. So people are making their own hotspots. Okay, let me choose this one. Okay, I'm giving it continue. So what else do we see here? We see observation day. We have to put an observation date. See, since it is a December, I'll put December 15 as my observation date. And we have observation type here. So we have traveling. If you have traveled a particular distance, then you have to click for this option. If you have been stationary, you have to click this one. If you have been historical being, birding was your not primary purpose, but you cannot estimate the start time and end time. So you can choose this. You can choose incidental. birding was not your primary purpose. Noting a bird was while during driving or gardening, you can just randomly put your checklist. We will put a traveling one, okay, for example. So we have to mention a start time. So I am putting start time as 6 a.m. here, okay. I have to click on a.m. Then duration, I have traveled 2 hours, say example, 0 minutes. And the distance, I'll say I have traveled 4 kilometers. You have an option for miles and kilometers. I am going with kilometers, which is because it is easy to understand and easy to estimate for me. Then we have party size. Okay, party size is how many number of people were with you when you made this trip. Okay, so assume me and 2 other people went. So totally 3 people. If you have a special comments, checklist comment, you can mention that. If you have seen any specific observations or you want to be specific about your checklist, you can do that. Let's give a continue. Okay, so eBird already shows me preferred bird list from that region. Okay, eBird already knows because it has a lot of data. It knows that people post these bird species from that region, they observe these birds. So eBird already gives me a ready-made list of birds. So under waterfall, we have these many birds. Under grouse, we have these many. Under pigeons and region, we have list of pigeons. Okay, so what you have to do is, if you have seen say for example, you've seen oriole, you type in oriole, okay, it comes here. If you observed Indian golden oriole, go for Indian golden oriole. You will see here Indian golden oriole. So you have to mention how many number of birds did you see in that region. So I am putting, if I have seen 2, sorry, I have seen 2. So now comes another question. Can I not be specific about golden oriole and its observation? I think there was a male and female. I should be mentioning about that. Can I do that? Yes, you can do that on the add details section. Okay, you can enter details of the bird. You can upload a media. You can upload its picture here. You can enter about its age, sex. Like, let me click that. Like, see if you have seen male, how many males. If male was immature, mature, adult, or age unknown. You can mention all these details here. If I'm observing a male adult, I'll say 1 male and female being 1. So this is how you distribute that. Okay, I think I have made myself clear here. And after that, if you have seen that bird, you want to upload now, you can see this option here in the right corner in the bottom. Are you sure submitting a complete checklist of the birds you were able to identify? Are you identifying the birds that you were able to identify? Are you uploading the birds that you were able to identify? You are just uploading the birds which you are just uploading. So if you could upload all the details of the birds and you're uploading the birds that you were able to identify, click on yes and then give submit. Okay, please confirm that you are reporting all species you detected. Yes, so I'm confirming now. After this, in camouflage in particular, if you are going, then it's fine, but it's not necessary that you wear a camouflage dress. Okay, next thing is be patient. Okay, really be patient. Let the bird come here. If you're looking at a bird and if you see that has perched in some place, like, don't make a fast move. Bird might tighten and it will fly away. Okay, in that way you will not be able to observe anything. Okay, so be patient, let the bird come. If you are also not seeing any bird, you have traveled to a place, you have traveled to a jungle, but you're not seeing any bird, be patient. Birds will come to you if you pay attention. If you pay attention to the calls, if you pay if you travel more distance, okay, you will see birds. Don't freak out. Then maintain distance from a bird. When you see a bird, maintain a safe distance from the bird. Don't go near the bird. The bird might see you and it will fly off. Okay, and go in small groups. Why? Because see, when you have a large group, like if you are taking school children or you're taking a big group, okay, what happens is people chat with themselves and that makes a lot of noise. and that will again scare the birds away. So birds that are you were supposed to see in the field, you will lose the chance of seeing them too. Okay. And then yes, inform your family, friends to which region you're going. It's a very good point. Okay. A lot of time what happens is people just venture out in new place. Okay. They don't inform their families, and family might worry that for a particular time you're not coming. So people sometimes lose themselves in the field. They like being there, so they spend more time in the field. They don't want to come to house right away, or they want to explore some more region in that locality. That happens. So inform your family to which region you're going. They will be worried. So inform them well before that to which region you're traveling to. Next thing is know about the place where you're going for bird watching well in advance. See, for example, if I want to go to a forest patch that is 50 kilometers away from here, I cannot blindly go into that place. Okay. So if you have heard that that place holds a good number of bird species, that are chances there, we can spot birds. If somebody has told you, you have to take a little research and knowing about the place that you're going in. So you can search that information from eBird about the bird species observed from that region, number of species that are there. And if you've seen all those birds already, and if you don't want to go there, you don't go there. And if you want to still explore that place, know about that place well before. Okay. Then carry some snacks and water in the field. Most of the time that you start walking for 2 kilometers and 4 kilometers, you might exhaust. You need water to hydrate yourself. Okay. Have some snacks. Okay. If you're traveling early in the morning for bird watching for the early hours, for the golden lights, you might. Not you're carrying a small snacks recommended. Okay, if you are in the field, that will really keep you not exhausted, and you can have some energy to travel. And there are don'ts. When the photography competition does not entertain any photographs that is taken of the bird nest, okay, or the hatchlings, okay, so do not disturb birds, leave them away right away. If you're seeing one, just stay away. Wants to make that bird come out that perch to this perch, or you want to see a bird that is making sound in the perch, but you don't know which bird it is. You want to see it. Somebody could throw a stone at them. So don't do that. Okay. I think the third point is explained before. Do not talk loud in the field. Again, birds will frighten away. Yeah, do not play music or songs while in jungle. People lose their interest in the middle when they don't see much of a bird species there. And if they're not enjoying it, they start playing music to, you know, go into another, which is really not recommendable. Don't do that. If you come to a purpose, finish your observations in the field, then move out of that place and do whatever you want to do. Do not play music and songs while you're in the jungle. Okay, the last thing. There are a few tips from experience that I can give you while you're in birding, while you're in the jungle, in the field. Okay, first thing is find a fruiting tree, dear friends. Find a fruiting tree, because birds like to if you are able to find a fruiting tree, you don't have to travel a long distance looking for other birds. All the birds will be already here. So, be keen in identifying a fruiting tree in the jungle or in your region. Say for a fig tree or a jungle, any fruiting tree that is around, you will find all the birds in that region. So, finding a fruiting tree will help you in bird watching. Then is learn to position yourself in the right position to photograph image light condition. I don't recommend this for if you're taking photographs. Do one thing, understand the light conditions. If the sun is behind you, it's good. If sun is in the face and it's against the subject, you will not be able to photograph a good image, no matter what. Okay, even if you know the better camera settings or whatnot. Okay, so learn to position your perch in this region. This plant and this particular perch, it can go to the nearby perch that is open for that bird, or go to that fruiting plant. So that is the understanding that you should have. You should not follow the bird to every place. You have to understand which place it's going to be next. So that will help you in one way. Then for all of you, I recommend this. Join the bird club in your region. We go on for Salim Ali bird counting. Okay, they go for wetland bird counting. Go, take participate in that. That's how you will enhance your skills in bird watching. That's how you will enhance your skills in identifying a bird. So being with experts. So as you see, as my fifth point, going bird watching with an experienced birder will help you, you know, learn few tips. See, there are giving tips in online class like I'm doing right now will be partly helpful. Okay, only when you're in the field and you face all the problems and learn things in the field, only will you know that the difference. And you can know that how the bird are doing and how they are dealing the unidentified birds post stage. Okay, and practice bird identification. Okay, I know these days bird photographs are available in every platform. Do follow a Facebook page that is dedicated for bird identification or bird photographs. Then Instagram pages, which are also dedicated for bird identification. That's how you do not really know how to use the binocular efficiently. So you have to practice that hand-eye coordination with the binocular on a moving object. Okay. I think that will be it. So since we are in a pandemic condition, a lot of people are stranded in the house. There are lockdowns in many places. So people cannot venture out in the nature. And there are a lot of restrictions in many places. So I would recommend you, you know, to start your bird watching session from your own garden. Start it from your own terrace. You can go onto your terrace. You can look around, observe what species of birds that you can see in that region. You can stay in your balcony. You can go to the nearby parks that are there. Okay. So this is it. I think I can take questions. From here on, as this session reads, good birders are not born, they develop their skills progressively with time and practice. Okay, and here is my email ID. If you want to ask any further questions in future, you can reach out to me in the email, and also you can write to me in the Instagram. This is my ID, Twitcher. Okay, and if there is time, I can show you. This is my photograph from the field. Okay, I'll just quickly show you some photographs that I have taken in the field. This is Andaman bulbul. It is endemic to Andaman Islands. Okay, you can see what are the striking colors that you can notice. Look at the tail patterns. The tail bars are not continuous. These are one kind of observation. The iris is blue in color. Okay. This can be one observation. then this is the drongo that I was mentioning about, which has four tails, but this is not a adult, it is a subadult, that's why it did not develop its fourth tail. Okay, and I was this is your great flamingo here. I have several more pictures, you can check it in the post. And we have owls here. This is Oriental Scops owl. Okay, so people can observe birds in the night as well. Okay, we can go for owling, we can go for nightjars. Okay, we have Andaman nightjar here. So these birds can be seen in the day, in the night. And I was telling you about preening, right? So here is preening. See?
No, I have it.
Anybody wants to? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. What can we do? How are you able to take the pictures perfectly? Because they may do some light moments, right? And how can we take it perfectly?
Which bird, ma'am? The night birds, owls, or the other birds? You're asking in general.
This bird, and you showed some pictures.
Oh, which one, ma'am? This one?
Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Which bird, ma'am?
Yeah, this one. Actually, not a ma'am. Yeah, Trishan.
Yeah, ma'am. I'm telling you. No, I'm calling you ma'am. Okay.
Oh, man. Oh, yeah. Yeah, this, how are you able to take it perfectly when they are doing small movements or...
You have to be keenly been observing the bird through your lens. You have to wait for the right moment. We look for birds which will make movements. Like, see, if you see in this picture, there were around 300, 400 flamingos. We were in a boat, okay, observing them. And we know that the bird might open its wing because it does few movements before opening it. So these are the observations that you will make in the field. And you have to stick with your camera and you have to be in a position when it makes, you have to be in the right place at the right time. So this is all practice, and I am not a very good photographer as I am as a bird watcher. I'm just a beginner in photographing. You can have best photographing tips that are available in YouTube, I say. So I was about to show you this picture. This is an Indian cormorant, okay? So see, now this cormorant is early in the morning. It's around 6:30 in the morning, okay? It was taken in the Kanchipuram near a lake, okay? Now the bird is preening its oil and spreading it across its feather. And okay, I have given the details here. This pose is called heraldic pose. It helps the preen oil to spread across the feathers and drives away parasites out from within the plumage and regular temperature. So this is done for regulating temperature. It is done to arrange the feather patterns. It is also to, spread the preen oil to keep the parasites away. So there are many things. We have a common kingfisher here. Okay, Harini. Harini.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
I think I'm almost.
Yeah. So.
And people can check this later. Also, I can take in questions right now. I'll just end my presentation. Is that okay?
Yeah. Yeah. So thank you so much, Karthik, for giving a very brief explanation to people who are very new to bird watching. So. There are a few questions in the chat box from the beginning. So before going to the question sessions, I'll just send the feedback link in the chat box. Please give your feedback about the session.
Yeah.
So just the first question, which was put forth in the chat box, is why is insect eating beak different from the green bean eater beak?
Why is
the insect eating beak different from the green bee eater's beak?
The question is, where is the question?
Yeah, so it is.
Are you asking from the picture that I've shown in the, I showed different types of beaks in the beginning, and you're asking the picture that you showed in the slide and in the word that you are mentioning, that a green beater, is both different because it is pointed, right?
Yes. So it was asked by Deepak Tarun. So yeah,
Deepak, it's adaptations to the nature. Like the green beater, it feeds when it is in the flight. So it gives it good. It is a good adaptation that it has a long beak and it can be able to catch it. I don't think there is a specific reason why it is having a long beak. It's all adaptations. I think in flight it is easy to catch with a long beak than having the small one. There are birds which also uses its small beak to catch bees, but not in the not accurately in the flight. So I think that is one. I'll try to look much detailed scientific reason for it. I'll post it in the WhatsApp group if you want me to. Next one.
So the next question is, what kind of beak is the parrot's beak?
What kind of beak is that? Like, let me check it. So it's a carnivorous seed eating type beak. Okay. So parrots feed on fruits. They chisel out the seeds out of the fruit. So it can be said as it is a carnivorous seed eating type. Okay, do anyone want me to show the slide again of that beak part?
So the person who has asked the question, so do you want the resource person to show the slide again? Okay, let me just check who has asked it. It was asked by Abhishek Vaidya. So Abhishek, are you here? Do you want him to show the slide again? Okay, I think we'll move on to the next question until he reverts back. So the next question is, do you recommend playing calls to attract a bird from vicinity?
Really, really an important question. Who are asked, like, they know the science behind that thing. It is really not recommended, guy. Like, who asked it?
Deepak Tarun.
Deepak Tarun, that's a very interesting question. I actually wanted to put that in do not section, but I did not put that purposefully because I don't want you guys to know, first of all, that there is something called as playback. So if you know some, like many times what happens, we introduce people to something that they are not supposed to do, and when they know the thing, they want to try it out. So that is why I did not want it to put in that section. I am personally recommending, and any birder would recommend, that do not play a call playback. Guys, do you know what call playbacks are? Like, anybody has a doubt what Tarun has asked?
No, I don't know.
What happens? See, there are birders, you know, who are so eager in taking pictures and so eager to wanting to see a bird. They play their recorded calls in the field using a speaker. Okay, in that way, that bird thinks that some mate has come or some threat has come. So the particular bird species which a bird has, I mean, which the caller has played, so that bird responds to the call and it comes to a particular perch, okay? And thereby the people take pictures of that, and this is how some people are doing their photographic sessions, and this is how they are going about with their bird watching tourings, etc. So it is not really recommended. Do not play callbacks. But there are scientific research that says that playing continuous callbacks or playing callbacks itself will harm the bird's behavior. It might scare, it might think that there's a potential threat for it. It might think that there is a strong opponent in the other side, which it would want to go and counterfight. So call playing back is a very wrong thing, and do not try it, do not do it. It is not ethical. Okay, anyone else?
Yeah, so there is another question. So there is one technique called DNA barcoding used to identify insects and animal species. Would you recommend it in case of birds?
I mean, it is already happening. DNA identification is already happening. For example, a Nicobar pigeon is the living example of it is the living a close relative of the extinct bird dodo. Like, I don't know if you guys know about it. We had a bird called dodo that was previously there, but now extinct. Nicobar pigeon is the close relative of dodo bird, and it was known after doing the DNA processing. So DNA identification is there, and it is happening in a lot of scientific research. But see, our main aim is to identify bird by visual. Okay, and DNA identification is not a common man's process. It involves a lot of scientific work, and it needs permission. So that is done by researchers. So our understanding and our aim is to identify birds by visuals, by photographs, and taking down all the informations and observation that I have talked previously.
Okay, so.
Actually, I have a doubt.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, actually, what is it? As you told that we can record all the calls.
Yes.
Yeah, from the birds. So yeah. You told that we can record through mobile. But we record through mobile. What happens is generally when we talk or record something normally, we are not able to hear the voice surroundings. Yeah, if you're talking a little far, because the air, sometimes the air blows. Right? Is there any solution if the bird is quite far? Like if I'm sitting...
Actually, only there are 2-3 ways. First solution would be you try to reach to that call's source where it is coming. You try to track down which region from it is it coming from. You go try to travel to that place, go near to it. Next thing is, I'm not asking you to have a device to record it. Since you have a mobile phone, it can come handy. It will help you in the post-processing. Okay, you can use that. And there are softwares, I think, I'm not really well aware, but I know that these softwares help you cut out the external noise that is there. Okay, so your job is to, note down that call's pattern, whether it was a single note pattern, whether it was a triple note pattern, and how was the call? Like there are birds which make chui, 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 and there are calls that makes a first call is higher and the second clause and the third note is duller. So this is how you observe, and then you go back to your home, search for the bird's calls and play back. Try to listen to the call that you have recorded and compare it with the call that is available in the net. That's how you will be doing. And another thing would be used to remember. Okay, next time. See, now if I tell you this is how crow sounds, you'll be like, that's weird. Like, I know how a crow sounds. So when you go on practicing these sounds, you will know that, okay, this is this bird. I think that's the way to deal with calls.
Okay, so the next question is, could you please tell the good binocular companies again, the names?
There are Carl Zeiss, I think. Let me check for it. Can you hold for a second if you don't mind? Carl Zeiss, Celestron, I think, and then Bushnell. These are all good binoculars, actually. You can go for Nikon's binoculars also. Okay, there are Decathlon branded good binoculars. So you can go for Bushnell Legend series. You can go for Carl Zeiss Terra ED. Okay, but these are all expensive. I would tell you from my personal experience that this is currently not required for you. I would recommend you to start using 8x42 binocular or 10x50 binocular. In particular, so you can go with any brand that has a reasonable price. Okay, I am using Olympus. Okay, Olympus 8x42.
Okay, so before going to the next question, Deepak has reverted in the text box and he wants you to show the chart again, the beak.
Okay, I'll just present right away. Yes, here is Deepak. Do you think it's not coniferous seed type. I mean, see, these are all not the exact type of beaks that are seen in the birds. There are birds that are missed out. There are beaks shapes that are missed out. The idea was to, you know, tell you that there are different kinds of bird beaks, and each bird beaks are varied. And these bird beaks and their shape will help you in identifying a bird. That is the whole idea of it. Do you get my point, Deepak?
Okay. Yeah. Shall we move on to the next question? So, Venkat wants to know, how can we distinguish between a male and a female bird?
See, usually what happens in the nature, males have a prominent color. They have a very colorful plumage, and it is, I'll show you one example. Okay, I'm sharing. Am I sharing now? No, right?
Harini? Yeah. No.
Okay, I'll share right away. One thing. So I was explaining, yeah, male females identification is by their plumage, and there are certain other characteristics that is there. Okay, one example I'll show you with the common one. I'll show you the difference between male female sparrows. Okay, can you see my screen now, Harini? Okay, yeah, is my screen. Okay, I'll show you how sparrow. Like here, this is a male house sparrow. You see it's actually male female difference is given in the field guide. Okay, I'll just tell you the example here. So can you see the white spot on the neck region on the back? So this is a distinguishing feature that, you know, separates male from female. So males will have this white patch. Okay, there are certain other points. And female, if you see, it does not have it. They have the streaked pattern entirely differently. Okay, so like this, if you want to check on other birds, say for example, Asian quail. Did you know Asian quail has a male and female difference also? So this here is a male. Okay, it's entirely black. The red, it has a red eye. This is a male. And you have a female here. The females here have these tail wing bar. They have a red eye too, but they are not black. They are a mixture of white and black, and it has body has different spots on it. Can you see the difference? So this is a female entirely. So this is how you can differentiate between two birds, two male and female. Now, and also, not every bird has male and female separately. Sometimes sexes are alike. Okay.
Yeah. So, moving on to the next question, which bird has most troubled you for IDing?
Of course, warblers.
Okay.
Warblers are hard to identify. Every birder has a hard time identifying it. Sometimes some birds are also hard identifying, like cuckoo shrikes and cuckoos also. Like you cannot, you have hard time differentiating between a Chinese sparrowhawk and other sparrowhawks also. You have a hard time differentiating two cuckoo shrikes. It happens, you know, this is how you learn. You have to make mistake. You make mistake, and then you learn from that. No, once what happened? I posted a common kingfisher. I posted a kingfisher's post picture in the Instagram. It turned out that the ID was wrong. Okay, I posted it as a common kingfisher, but it was indeed a blue-eared kingfisher. It was then corrected by a resourceful person who is experienced in the field, who is my mentor. So mistakes, I'll also suggest you that don't be afraid of making mistakes in this field. Don't be afraid of making a wrong identification. See, developing a skill is not easy. It comes by time. So take your time in learning this process. Go on to field, be in this field, and practice IDing. That's how it will work. Then.
Okay, so these are just me. It's not telling few questions which are kind of repetitive. So which field, Kaid, would you recommend for a complete novice, and which do you personally use it in?
Sorry, I'm not clear about the question. Can you ask again?
Yeah. So which field guide would you recommend for a complete novice, and which do you personally use, if any?
So I wouldn't tell you which to use. Okay. So it's a personal choice again. I am using Birds of India, which I showed you earlier, and I'm using Birds of Indian Subcontinent. I think I'll have to share the screen again to show them which it is exactly. So I'll keep my screen shared, I think, till the end of the session. So, see, I'm using, can you see my screen now?
Yeah, it is visible.
I am using this book. See, I didn't buy all of them. Some books were gifted. And also, you can give them to your fellow Birdwatcher friends. You can give them as a birthday gift. You can give them as a year gift. I received both these books from my friend. I received this when I was in the birdwatching training program. It was provided to me. And also, I received this first when I earned my first salary. So one of my mentor bought me this when they saw interest in birds. So he bought me this book. Then I had a gift of this book. I also prefer to use this book. So it totally depends on individual choice, whichever. I used all three of them to find different descriptions, to look on their features. Okay. I also refer eBird for real-time picturing. Okay. I also ask people who are good in this field. I share the pictures with an expert. I then come to conclusion that it is this bird, and I learn from them. So learning is a process. You can still be a student when you are in the field. Next, please.
Next question is, what's the best method to collect bird calls? So Deepak, he uses RecForge and Raven Pro. And is there any directory or call library to refer to?
Zenocanto, there is a website where you can download bird calls. And eBird also has some bird calls. And actually, there is an app which will all ease your work in identification. I don't want it to tell you guys that you have an app which will ease all your work in identification. It is also developed by Cornell Lab. Its name is Merlin. You have an app called Merlin in which all these things are there already pre-stored. You just have to choose between two birds, like I showed you in the beginning. You have to narrow it down, and all the bird descriptions and everything comes in. You will see a 20 word out of all the markings that you have mentioned, and you have to choose your bird. And then when you have chosen a bird, you will see all the details. Why I didn't want to propose you that thing is, see, that makes your work very easy, and that is now how bird watchers should be doing it. If you want to develop your skill, you should go into the field, develop your skills by, you know, practicing IDing. And like, imagine you have an homework and your parents are doing your homework, but you are learning nothing from that. So that's how it will be. So that's why I didn't mention about Merlin app. And there are other apps too that I don't want to mention also. These things can help, in identifying birds, but I would recommend that you go by all these processes. Only then you can become a good bird watcher in this field. I'm not against these apps, but if you want to develop your skill, start practicing on your own. Next, anything?
Yeah. So the next question is, after taking a photo, we share it on social media. Does it increase the threats of poaching?
No, it does not increase the threats of poaching by posting a picture. And see, do not mention the place exactly, even in eBird also, or even in your location, if the bird is really threatened. Okay. You have a lot of endemic or exotic species. I mean, there are a lot of endangered species which are not supposed to be, in the social media. People who see these posts, go on to that place, exploit that resource, and next time you go to that place, that bird is not seen again. So don't be specific. If you think that the bird is concerning, don't upload the exact location of it. You can just mention. So we have a parody in bird watching in South India. Like people who watch different birds in this region, they mention that they just blindly mention it is outskirts of Chennai. Okay, nobody knows where this outskirts of Chennai is exactly, but people mention it as outskirts of Chennai. So likewise, you can mention just the region. Like you are in Bhopal, you can just mention Bhopal. Which region? That's it. If I'm in Chennai, I am just specifying the state or the district. That's enough. You don't have to be specific about it when you post it on social media. That's a really good question.
Kartikeyan, this has reported in many areas, especially in Kerala also. Only one bird has come, and that too posted by somebody. This type of incidents many happened.
Yeah, that's right. So this is what happens when we see. So this happens in case of Great Indian Bustard. You know the Great Indian Bustard is a critically endangered bird, and it is very less in number, and it is distributed to a very narrow region of space. Okay, they are distributed to a very particular region, and when people and a lot of efforts are going in protecting these species. Okay, forest department are working, various NGOs are working, but what happened due to some photographers and some birders who post the exact location of the bird, some people, as ma'am mentioned, go into that place, they poach it, do many things. So that is one thing that you can refrain from. And I have seen also in various birds platform, people have posted Great Indian Bustard picture, and they have mentioned the region, but the admins have recommended them not to mention about it. They should remove it immediately, and those information has been removed then and there. That is one way.
Okay, so there is one last question. There are two last questions. So
I'm happy to.
Yeah. I'm telling to people. So if you have any further questions, feel free to post it in the chat box. Sorry, not the chat box, WhatsApp chat group, or else you can personally mail Kartikeyan. So he'll be very happy to answer the questions. So we are running short of time. So we'll just end the session with the last two questions. So Satyabhama ma'am wants to know if you watch nocturnal birds.
What are nocturnal birds?
We watch nocturnal birds. Yeah.
Nocturnal birds again. See, so let me tell you the difference between nocturnal and diurnal birds. Diurnal birds are that we see in the daylight conditions, okay, and we have nocturnal birds that we see in the night, owls, nightjars, etc. See, it's purely an observation. You go into the field, and that you know that these region might habit an owl. Okay, you go into that field, you listen to the calls that are made by the owls, so you go in search of it. We carry a torch, okay, we identify it, which bird species is that, okay, if it is, if you go through my Instagram page, you will find oriental scopsels, you will find Indian bobok, okay, Andaman hawks. So these are all birds that we have encountered in Andaman Islands during nights. We go around taking a torch in hand, we look, we listen to the calls, and we track them down, we take photographs as possible. And nightjars again, when you use your torch around that place and the eye blinks, and then you know that the bird is there. That is one of the methods that we use. So I can recommend you for a birding trip in Andaman where you can, where I can or some of the resource person can show you the nocturnal birds.
Okay. Deepak, the Instagram username is what he's displaying on screen. So you can actually check the in his screen, you can check his account. The last question is, how can we identify the birds like peregrine falcon which is fastest, and how can we track the birds with that much height other than binoculars? What are the other requirements for identifying from greater height?
See, let me open up Peregrine Falcon bird. Okay. I have not seen Peregrine Falcon first of all myself. Anyway, have a look at, so this is an observation. See, you have this picture here. So this picture here we have, what are the prominent thing that you can notice in this picture? Okay, you can see the chest barrings. Okay, you can see the eye color, or the the regions near it, and you can see the white bars near the shoulder. These are one kind of way. And in flight also, you can see anyone wanting to say something?
No, somebody has not muted, I guess.
Okay. I'm not an expert in this particular bird, or I cannot comment on it right away without being noticed for myself in the first place. But you can see the flight difference. You can compare it with any bird that you see in the perch or in flight. You can compare that bird with the other photographs that you are that you have in the internet. You can check the resourceful platforms like eBird and other citizen science update, where you can check these photographs. If you see the wing pointation, the wing bar pattern, and how it is distributed from chest, it is not from the neck, it is from the chest. So these can be some of the differences that you can notice. People also ask that how it is different from Amur falcon and Peregrine falcon and Amur falcon's difference. So these are all photographic differences. I'm currently not an expertise in this question. I'm sorry.
Thank you so much, Karthikeyan, for giving us your time. And then I just asked, can you identify the birds from
any questions from YouTube?
No, there are no questions from YouTube, so I'm just having a constant check on the same. So Shahin, if you still want to discuss on the same, please feel free to ping him personally. He's there in the WhatsApp group also. So thank you so much, Karthikeyan, for your time. So this was
thank you so much. Like, I mean, as I told you, like, this was my first ever online session, and thanks to Science Chronicle and to Harini for conducting such a beautiful session. And I was really nervous when I was beginning, and I think throughout the session it was going good. People were really responsible, people were really good, and happy to have you guys here. Any questions that you have through the session, you can ask, as Harini told you. You can send questions to the email address, or send directly to Science Chronicle, to Harini, or in the in the WhatsApp group. Thank you all.
His mail ID and his Instagram name will be shared in the WhatsApp group as well. So thank you so much, guys. Have a great weekend. Thank you so much. Bye bye.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much.